Itself, I thought we'll talk about in a basic way, and so since it's a very small group, it's nice that like we can actually discuss. Stop me anytime. So I will tell some points, and then like we can write a test, and then we can check what that program is supposed to do, that sort of thing. So we'll write the code. So stop me anytime and ask me the questions. Let's start. So have you guys used arrays in Go? Anyone? Arrays. Oh, why do you use it for what?
Collect objects or collection of objects.
Okay, then do you think arrays and slices are the same?
I believe they have been used interchangeably, and I really don't find any differences out there.
Okay, as far as I've seen, like I've never used arrays. Or even Go says like we don't need to use arrays itself because it is very restrictive. Which what it means is like we would never like of course if you have a use case sure fine, but this is very restrictive in a way that like you define a array of size 4 and you use the elements in it and the size is restrictive. And when you actually want to extend the array or when you want to reduce the elements, it's really hard. And like we'll see the differences, but before that, like when you pass this, like so this is the array syntax. Like you say the size and you say the type and that will be the array. And when you pass it around, what do you think? Is it a reference or a pass by value? Like or generally in Golang? Pass by value. So if I mutate it inside, like basically I'm creating a blah which have some n elements and I'm mutating it and then I print the elements here and I also print it here. Let's see what happens. I was experimenting something. Let me just change it. Okay, I printed everything, fine. So this is the array and we actually mutated it. But when we see it outside, it is still the same. Probably I should comment the other stuff so that it would be much more visible. Inside it is actually 100 changed. But when you see it outside, it's actually different. And it's actually passed by values. Now, imagine if you want to pass a long array, like as a pass by value, it's going to take memory also. So in order, like since we are saying it is very restrictive and even array of size 4 and array of size 3 is actually different types. It's not even same. It is not very extensible. All those things. Slice is the very suggested way in Go to use it. Like everywhere, wherever you see the code, it will be mostly slices. So the slice is actually like you don't define a length. Let's just remove it.
Slices also there must be an array underneath.
Yes, but we'll check what it is underneath. Whether you say array or slices, it is actually a sequential memory which have some content in it. But how you deal with that sequence, like that set, is what it differs. So in array, you actually say it's an array of 4, which means it allotted 4 chunk, and then you use that. You can't change it. But in slices, you can actually easily change it. And like I'll show you one thing. Like slices actually by default, it's passed by pointer. This makes a huge difference because I've seen code where people pass a pointer, an address of a slice, which doesn't make sense at all. So like func blah data, sorry, func mutate slice, let's say data of slice, this array of int, and this will be same. Like you can actually pass both of it, so we can actually check it. So I'm actually creating a slice here. This is a slice without any size. 1, 2, 3, 4, slice, and then I can say mutate slice of SL, and I can also say mutate slice of this. I think it will error out, but it doesn't matter. I'll tell you why. Yeah, it will error out. So when you say this pointer to int, it doesn't. It shouldn't. You shouldn't actually do this. So that is passing. This is a different issue. I will tell you why, because we'll go and look here. Like this, there's a nice blog which is a default Golang thing. So when you actually pass slices around, it passes it by value, but what it passes is actually a struct. And as you said, it is actually backed by an array. Like we call it as array, like whatever, some memory chunks. But the array will have a length and capacity. In slices, it can change. You can vary it, but in arrays, you can't. So in this case, you're actually passing this particular struct, which has a pointer to the backing array, and how many elements in it, that is the length. And capacity is like, you have 8 elements, you have 8 memory allotted to it, but you have only 4 elements in it. Like, do you guys know how the usual array works? You, like, whether it is Java, Python, anything, right? You usually append elements, but do you guys know how it grows in size?
So there must be copies the entire content to some other bigger.
Correct. So yes, whatever he is saying. So when this particular size chunk memory increases, like you want to insert one more, we basically create a new memory chunk with a bigger size, and we add elements to it. But most of the code, what it does is, when you have elements, let's say 2, your size will be 2. But when you add element 3, it won't necessarily increase to 3, but rather it will increase by twice, so 4. And when you have a add fifth element, it will add it by like 8. So the size of the underlying slice or array will grow as 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. Like it will grow 2 to the powers. Yes. So because when you inserted like 33rd element, it makes sense to have a 64 size array. Like because copying is also some time consuming. Process consuming thing. So this is a sample thing. Ask me if you have any questions in the code. We are getting a size and then we are creating a slice. So I created slice in that place with this structure. This is actually creating it and also initializing it at that particular point of time. You declare it, you know the elements. But if you don't know it, generally this would be the case. You actually make it. It's almost similar to malloc or NC or stuff like that. You make a slice of int. You say the size and capacity. Like you don't generally say it. It's just like you say 5 and then like you can ignore the length. It's fine. Here we create with capacity 0. So what it means is I'm in this case we are explicitly saying, hey, create an array with 0 element, and then we are adding elements to it. So, and whenever you add element, there is internally something happening in the append, which is what we were discussing, but we can actually do it explicitly. So for each and every element, we add it and we are printing the capacity and length and pointer of that particular slice. So let's see in main. So I'm calling slices with 11 and go build. So if you notice, this is the case. So initially the capacity is 3 and you added 3 elements. The moment you add 4th, it becomes 6. And the moment you add 7th one, it becomes 12. And you can also note the pointer is changing. So which means the underlying array, like you won't get contiguous memory, right? So you have 3 elements, and if you want to add 3 more elements, you won't get memory because it would be used by some other place. So you actually get memory in some other place where you have 6 size, and then you assign it, and then you use it. So this is what's happening, like exponential growth. Any questions? Like I think makes sense. So here there is a sample copy. Yeah. So this is almost doing the same thing. Like internally, like we added an element with using the function called upit. That is the most frequently used in all the places. And whenever you want to add element in slice, you actually make the type, and then you add the length, and you multiply the capacity by 2. And then for each and every element, you actually copy it to the thing. And you also have the function to do it, which is copy. So, which means we can actually assume whenever you actually append an element to a slice, internally it creates a new set and then copies all the array elements and then puts it back. So yeah, so this is one. But now when you actually mutate it, now let's say you create a slice and then let's call mutate with data of int, and let's say data of this, and let's see what is the data now. Okay, so in this case the data is actually mutated, because though it is passing the struct pointer to slice, the internal backing array is same, because you are actually passing a pointer to the existing memory chunk. You actually change it in a different function, it is actually affecting it. So which means it's a pass by value, but the internals is pass by reference, because it's a pointer. So which means you never need a pointer to it. This statement made sense, right? It's actually reference, but not exactly reference. It's a pass by value of some struct defining the slice. Given that array, we said it is very restrictive, but like I think.
So one strange thing is, a slice length is like 4, but array length is 8.
Yeah, yeah, because you can access anything, but. No, but the length is defined as something, right? When you try to index something which is out of the particular index, like the length, I think it will say index out of memory. Sorry, index exception. So if we explicitly make with a capacity 8 and you added 4 elements, it's actually a slice of 8 elements. But if you use a slice with 3 elements and you add it and you don't know what it is underlying, then it would error. So you are basically saying blah make, it's a int and the size is 8, the length is 3. I can access a blah of 7. I can access it. No, it's not, because you know that it is 8 elements. We can actually try to run it. Let me also confirm. But one important point I forgot. When you actually create an array, by default everything is created with 0. But when you create a slice, it's actually nil. Blah. I just type random things to differentiate. So length is larger than capacity. It was otherwise. So let's revert it. Evaluated but not used. Fine. Yes. So here it is printing only these things. It should be actually nil. It is not nil here. This is nil. I was about to say this. So this will be nil. This is actually like blah is actually like we created the stuff. So now your question, will blah of 7 work or 6? Yeah. So nil and the default value is actually equivalent, right? That way. We'll check it. But to your question, like, does this answers? Okay. So it is not actually creating it.
What 8 means is that you can add more elements to it without allocating new memory. So what that before statements tell him.
Yes.
So if yes. Selling glass 8 means, so you can allocate 8 more elements without allocating any more elements.
No, so I remembered this, but I wasn't sure because we'll just verify. Because when you access something with index, right, you have length, and then you first check when you write code, what will it be? Like if the index is greater than length, then panic. Yeah, of course, it would, right? So it means it's erroring out.
I don't know.
So, like I was about to say this, but you guys already went into the slicing. We can actually create a some subset of the slice, and we can actually create a subset out of a bigger slice, but still the backing array would be the same. So you have 5 elements. You say, hey, I need this 2 chunk, like 2 elements. You can actually slice it. It's almost like Python if you guys used it. It is the same, but the backing array is still same. So which means if I change something here, it will also change this. But I doubt, I don't know whether we can access smaller of 2. Because if you notice, smaller capacity and length is 2. So let's just verify. So it would, yeah. No.
So do it like
1
to
2
and then
access 1 to 2 and access what? But this is still out of length, right? Because this one, if you notice, it's actually 2 elements, just 2 elements.
Yeah.
No. So here, if you say 1 to 3, 1 to 4, this, we can actually print this. Capacity and this thing, percentage D. So this is capacity and this is length, and this we don't want it. Length, sorry, cap.
It makes sense.
Huh, we'll just print it. It's fine. Yeah. I hope everyone can be sure then. So, oh, sorry. So capacity is 7, but still, like, which means you're actually pointing to the older thing. Like the capacity of this is nothing, right? We didn't say anything. But when you say capacity, it's the older, bigger array, the blah thing in our case, and the length is 2. And any time you try to access something which is out of the length, it's index out of range. Yeah, so that clarified, right? Yes? Okay. So yeah, that is slicing. So we saw multiple things. One, slice is a pass-by value, but it's a struct which uses a pointer, which means it's a reference to the same existing arrays, and you can slice some sub-chunks out of the slice, and even if you change the sub-slice, it will affect the same thing because it's basically the existingly same thing. So generally we would use slices, but I want to do one code example. Which expresses using a pointer of slices. You can actually tell me what is wrong there. Like, we'll experiment here. So let's just write a function which takes a slice, get me something like get first even element, something, right? And this is a slice of int. And let's say this is data. And this have to return me an integer. So let's just pass a pointer Oh, wait, sorry. So let's just pass a pointer, a slice. Let's say get first even a slice of integer. So like this is a very contrived example, but what I'm trying to say is, let's say you have huge records in your database, like a lot of customers. Then you want to get only some customers which is matching some criteria. Usually people tend to put pointers because they think structs will take more memory. Generally it is not that much, but still people prefer pointers. Unless you're using it explicitly for changing the structs, like I wouldn't suggest it. But let's stick to that case, like that I'm changing it to the some integers. So basically data of int is, let's say, customers, and you want to return a slice with the data, right? Like with some criteria. In our case, event is the criteria. So like this signature makes sense, right? So let's just try to write a test. Like I think I can write a test for this first. So test first even number result something. This I'm actually using a library called testing, stretcher testify, which is actually pretty cool. Like we use this for mocking testing everything. Like we can go discuss about this later. So this the function will be get first even number out of a data, and this data will be, let's say, 7. Okay, so result is this, and we pass in data, and the expectation should be assert.equal result. Len of result should be 1, right? Because in this case, it's just one thing, only one element we are expecting. So only one element. And also we are expecting, what should be the result here? Like result of first element. Yes, 10. 10, okay. So this is fine. This is actually an example how we do the whole testing thing. We actually write tests and then we break it. And then we try to make it pass. Experiment return null. Here I can return null and I'll pass. So go test. So this is failing. So let's just implement it. So for each element in data, if element mod 2 is 0, I haven't used mod for a while. This is fine, right? Sorry? Oh, I forgot. So if this is the case, then you actually say append. So this will be a result, var result. It's a slice of integer. You basically append result append to result, and this will be the case. Like this is how we append it generally. So do you notice this? Like even if I do a append an element to existing slice, you have to assign it back to the thing, because it's since it's a new memory chunk, you have to assign it back. So that is one thing to notice. Then let's return result. Fine. So let's just run this. No, that is because I did a go test and then it was failing. It is not result declared and not used. Sorry, why you're saying not compile? It won't import. It won't. I created a new one. That was the mistake. So go test. We need to refer it. Like, we got some result, but we just need to check the value properly. So result of zero, result. Fine. Yes. Tell me. Huh? Like, so you got it, right? Like, expected is 10, but the actual is 7. This is the test case. This is the test case. Like, I will go back to the code. This is the implementation. Very simple implementation. You guys tell me. Huh? Huh? Oh, range it simply iterates through each and every elements, and this first one is basically the index, and the second one is actually the value that you get out of it. Exactly. Like, did you guys get it? So it's very simple. It looks very straightforward. But this particular E is actually a single variable. So which means this E, printer percentage P, fine. Like I have to print this, sorry, what is it? Minus? Oh, yeah. It's like I think percentage P is also a pointer, like which we were using it. But let's see. So it's basically the same address, and it's the same variable. But what you actually returned is this particular pointer, this particular address. So we can actually print this. So It's a single variable, it's a single memory. You're iterating through a slice each time you copy that to the same address. And what we actually return is this particular address, not the value. So result. Hi, this will work. So, which means we are actually returning the address, and if you notice, ideally, it should have stopped by 3. Like, we are not stopping because it's iterating through it. We are not returning inside the code. Like, we are not returning here. If we would have done that, that would also work. But since, like, this example or this particular requirement is, you have to go through all customers, and like, if it matches, you have to return it back. So, which means you will also go through odd numbers in this case, let's say. And you are copying that odd number value into this particular place, right? So which means you are actually giving the value which is the last or even next to it. So we can change the test experiment test. I'll just close this. Yeah. So this will be, let's say, fine. Let's keep smaller numbers. This is actually going through everything, so which means this particular thing stops at the last element, and you, since you have an address, you actually set the address at the third place, which is actually at the value of 10, but since you are copying the value into this particular address, the value finally you expected is polluted.
So,
yeah.
For this example also, for this use case also, you could have returned the address of that particular index of that slice.
No, but okay, what I'm trying to say, you can do that, but what I'm trying to say is don't use pointers unless it is necessary, because you can actually you will misuse it. The reason you have to use pointer is you have to have a struct, and let's say you are passing it around and everybody can change the content of the struct. So let's say you have a customer and you say block the customer, and which means customer dot whitelisted or blocked is true. So somebody else is changing the attribute of that particular struct, then you use pointers, which means you are passing something around. You know, whenever you see a pointer, something could be affected. But whenever you don't pass a pointer, it don't have to be. So in this case, why would I have to still have to stick to pointer to index? Like, pointer, you use it because one, you have to change it, and second thing is when you pass it around, it's a single thing, like it's a memory. If you pass a struct with, let's say, a million elements, then it obviously will be higher memory consumption. So that's why they do it. But unless it is required, you shouldn't do it. So in this case, it is very obvious, but basically I was trying to figure out an issue which overall, like let's say 100 use cases and then like one issue happened. I would never check this get first event because this is a very simple code. Like basically what happened was it's a big issue, but finally dropped down to this. Then I was like, oh my God, like why did people do this? So yeah, the learning is like you have to use pointers only when it is required and only when you understand it. And slices, yeah, I think we've gone through pretty much that's it. Like it's very simple. And if there is any questions, I can answer. Like I didn't have a lot of content because I wanted to keep it simple and then discuss it. Yeah, even if you have a question around this test or anything, we can talk.
Correct.
Yeah, that time like you have to have a mutex or something. Whenever you have goroutines, you have to think about race conditions and stuff like that. But even in goroutines, we pass it as values and you pass it as a parameter. Like you do, like generally we don't let the goroutines use a global slice or something. That will also result in race conditions. So yeah, it's true. Like mostly we shouldn't prefer pointers unless it is required. You guys can also tell like if there is any question like pointers, you need to use it, or like if you're not yet convinced, we can discuss.
In this test, when you pass back the pointer, the length of zero should be showing right?
No. So the code which we have written is to get the first even number. So which means the expectation is 10. That's why we have expectation is 10.
Yeah, that's understood.
Huh.
In the result case, we're expecting 10, but your result is written as 9.
Yes, so that's what we were talking. So in this case, we have a pointer to backing array. We are not copying elements to it. So when we saw this code, you are actually, let me just print one more thing and then explain. Pump.println. This is the place. Oh, sorry. What was error? Yeah. So we have five elements in data, right? 3, 5, 10, 7, 9. And whenever you reach 10, this is the place. You assigned it. But what you actually return back is the address. Like you actually return a list of addresses you interested in. But since we are using E, like E is a, like you are using some memory, one particular memory, to iterate through all the values. Though you say this is the memory, it will be overwritten by the next call, right? Because you are reading the next value here, the next value here. And finally, when you return, it will have the last value. So like I will also print the result to be more explanatory. So this is the place E, okay, and this is the place comma E. So this will be the data. Oh, sorry. Let me do this. So the data is 3, 5, 10, but when you see 10, you are returning a pointer, but the pointer is still same. And the data 7 is returned into that address. And next time 9 is returned to the address. So that's why you have a result which is still 186A0. And when you try to read something from it, the last value is there.
That's because the address of E was returned, that's right.
Yes. No, the address of E is returned. Yes, yes, yes. Like this will exactly map to your use case if you have some list and then you want to iterate and then return values. And generally it would be a struct and people will put pointers. So to simply like it's a hack, but like ideally you should have returned a slice of integer because we told that it's a reference, right? I can do this and then it will work fine because I'm creating a new thing and then I'm returning it. right? So let's just test this. Oh, sorry. Oops. Invalid indirect of E. Sorry. Append result blah ampersand. Yes. I mean, this is still wrong, but this will pass. Because you are creating a new variable and then assigning the 7 somewhere else, and then you are adding that address here. Because while iterating the E's content is polluted. But in this case, it's a separate variable. But still, you shouldn't prefer this. Like, you can just put, I don't know why you need it. Like, I think the point is, you don't need a slice of something to a pointers. I mean, unless it is required, like, don't do it. And I've also seen code like this. This is very, very weird. Like, you have a slice to a pointer. You have a pointer data inside each and every element that is a slice. Then you have a pointer to the slice itself. Like, I cannot tolerate that. But yeah, so you don't do it unless it is required and you have a use case. And like, if not, there will be some use cases. There will be some mistakes. Then it will be really hard to figure out, especially when there is a pointers. Cool.
How is it working? Create a new variable, then it's going to be of same type, right?
Huh.
Address. So
yes.
It's going to point to the same location.
No,
it is the address of variable.
So here you can see, right? The address of E is 186A0. But when you create a variable, it's a new variable. So here it is 186D8. It's a new variable.
That is address of variable.
Yeah. So you are basically creating a new address somewhere else and then copying the value,
so
and then you are returning that.
This scenario not applicable to the range in that variable.
Sorry.
You are creating E once when you initiate a loop and you are reusing the same E again. But here inside the loop, you have the iteration part again.
Okay.
It's creating a new value.
Yes. Because when you assign something in Go, it is new variable, but there it is a reference. Yeah, there it is a reference too. Let's not go there. Yes. Yes. No, there is a reference, right? There is a program which is using the blah. Like, in this case, it's test. But there will be some other place where you will be using the final results.
No, if you just assign blah to something, and then let's say you use it to something,
you have to explicitly free it. If there is a reference, it wouldn't free the memory. So then definitely it won't assign it to something else. If it is garbage collected, then you can get it. But when you say it's garbage collected, which means there's no reference, right? Okay. Sorry, we can discuss, I want to just show one example for the test that you guys were talking about mocks stuff, right? So I'll show a service. Like, this is my some code, but I'm not talking about that thing. So here there is a, we are calling some service, let's say. Here I have a dependency, fine. And from that dependency, I'm getting something. This dependency, like card provider, what it does is we get some values from Redis. This is a fetching from Redis. So when I try to write test for this, I don't generally want the provider to hit the Redis. So here I'm creating a mock, and then this is where I say, hey, when I see a get cards with this particular arguments, you return this. Like, this will imitate multiple flows, and then you can write the test. Like I just wanted to show an example since you were asking. So this is actually mocked in our test. And if you're asking whether the get cards is tested, we would have already returned a test for this get cards. This is actually hitting Redis and testing. So yeah, so if you're not interested in the implementation of something, whether it is Redis or whether it is some other very computational heavy thing, you can actually mock it by this way. And yeah, I just wanted to show an example since you were asking. That's all I had. And I will actually commit this code to GitHub. I can share it. And this link, Go Slices and Internals, you guys can check it out. It's basically the same thing. It is very simple. You can check it out. And you can reach out to me in Slack or mail if you have any questions. My handle is Dinesh Kumar. And by the way, I'm Dinesh. I work in Gojek. I've worked in multiple languages. And here, mainly, we are using Golang because we have huge scale. And like even when you scale, Go is very less memory footprint, all those things. Like I've been using it for a while. And yeah, it's been nice. You can ask me any questions if you have related to CI/CD deployment or anything regarding Go REST services. You can reach out to me. Yeah, that's all I had. Thank you. Thanks.